It's gonna be a lot of slow singing and flower ringing. My alarm goes to ring.
Yo. Yeah, we up in here jamming, y'all. We be up in here jamming all day long. Yeah. Yo, and we are back with more G.L.U.E. Movement Radio. Yeah. And as we all know, as everybody know, when we come back on G.L.U.E. Movement Radio after our first segment, we always take Q&A. So while I was on a break, I got some questions, and they are some good ones. But like I said, I take all questions, I take all everything. So please, while I'm on here, while I'm giving my spiel and going over my thing, and while we having this talk show, I love discussions. You know what I'm saying? I like talking with people. I like interacting. I don't like just sitting up here talking. You know what I'm saying? I like to get interaction. So if you have any questions, comments, whatever, please feel free to leave them on my Facebook Live. Please feel free to leave them on my Instagram Live, because I love talking with the people. So the question we got is, we were talking about Adam and Eve and how Adam and Eve is a parable for the relationship between a black man and a black woman. And the question that we got was, is it possible for homosexuals to be fully conscious? That was the question that we got. Is it possible for homosexuals to be fully conscious? So we are live back on the air, and as I said, we do take the questions as they come. So, hey, ain't no eggshells for me to walk on. Me personally, I don't judge homosexuals or lesbians, whatever may have them, because I have them in my family, and I love them dearly. Dearly, I love them. So I don't judge them myself. I'm used to the church background saying y'all going to hell and this and that, and half of them who on the pulpit are already in hell. You know what I'm saying? So I don't judge them at all whatsoever. So a lot of people ask that question of, when they hear me talking about Adam and Eve, does that exclude the homosexual? Does that exclude the lesbian or whatever may have you? And my thing with me is, even when I was in the college and I used to do Black Student Union, we used to have people come in from the LGBTQ club, you know, that was right down the hallway and had the same meeting days that we had. And the crazy thing about it is, even me conversing with the blacks from the LGBTQ club, even they were telling me that in the LGBTQ community, there's discrimination. And I'm like, damn, you know, I thought the reason that, you know, blacks, you know, who were homosexuals and lesbians went to the LGBTQ community because it was a community where everybody learned how to come together and be one. And a black person from the LGBTQ community told me that even in the LGBTQ community, there is discrimination and there is racism. So I'm like, wait, damn. So me, I'm always dealing with the issue of being black. That is what I do. I deal with the issue of being black. And one thing about the scripture, the thing about me is this. It deals with the nature of a person. Remember, when we was brought over here from slavery, we were ripped up and we was torn up from our nature. We was torn up from who we naturally are. You understand what I'm saying? So the whole purpose of slavery was to put all of us in an abnormal state of being. And let me be perfectly clear about what abnormal state of being is. When a black man is killing another black man, that's an abnormal state of being. We were not like that before slavery. When a black man is abusing his woman and talking down on his woman, that is an abnormal state of being. We were not like that before slavery. When a black woman is going against her man or turning on her man or betraying her man or speaking down on her man and belittling her man and destroying the self-esteem and confidence of her man, that is an abnormal state of being. We were not like that before slavery. Everything. There is a book, I believe, don't misquote me, but I believe the book is Jimmy Barber, if I'm not mistaken. But the name of the book is called The Creation of the American Negro. the creation of the American Negro. And I don't know if it's Mr. Baldwin, I'm not sure, but somebody can Google it up and they can tag it on here. But it says the creation of the Negro. And the reason why, even when I was talking to my sister from London, I said, before we can even understand who we are, we have to unlearn so many things. We have to go through a complete unlearning process in order for us to even fully come into the knowledge of who we are. In order for us to even understand the knowledge of who we are, in order for us to even fully walk in the knowledge of who we are, there are so much things that we have to be unlearned. So another time that this question oftentimes comes up, and it comes up a lot, it does come up when talking about the Willie Lynch letter. And a lot of people who are of alternative lifestyles, they don't believe in the Willie Lynch letter, because the Willie Lynch letter details all of the things that slavery would create in the black community. It says slavery in the black community would create division, and it would create us fighting each other, and it would create us harming each other, and it would create us hurting each other. It says slavery in the black community would create division and separation between the old and the young, and the light and the black, and the male and the female, and the female with the long hair, and the female with the straight hair, and the female with the curly hair, and the tall brother, and the short brother, and the fat brother, and the skinny brother. It would create divisions on all levels of the black community. You understand? And it also said one purpose. It said that the Willie Lynch letter said that what slavery will do when you are constantly emasculating the male, and anybody who is a strong male, anybody who is a assertive male, anybody who is what they would call a aggressive or untamable male, they would hang that male up in front of all the other slaves, and they would tie his legs to different horses, make them run in different directions to rip his limbs off. They would hang him up and butt bust him, sodomize him. They would rape the black male in front of the other slaves. They would tar them up and feather them and burn them and hang them while burning. They would completely emasculate any images of strength in the black community, so that even when the woman raised the children, she would raise the children to be mentally weak yet physically strong. And any time that a male would rise up to be physically strong, the mother would see black masculinity, would see black strength as something to be targeted by the slave masters. She would see black strength with being synonymous with what they did to the kings and the chiefs that was brought over from slavery. So her own protective mechanism for her child would make her raise the child to be softer, to not fight, to not resist. If she had to, she would become the disciplinarian, and she would beat any signs of strength or resistance out of the son so that he could survive. The strength and assertiveness and masculinity of the male is for thriving. It is for growth. It is for conquering. It is for advancing. It is for carrying the nation forward. When you strip this masculinity out of the male, yes, it protects them from the brunt of the slave master because they're no longer a threat, but that is also the part of the male and the part of the nation that moves the whole entire culture forward. So now this emasculates the man and puts the man in the back. And now this puts the woman in the front in a masculine position. You understand? So the Willie Lynch letter says that what slavery will do is it will begin to reverse the gender roles. It will put the woman in the male's position, and it will put the male in the woman's position. And what Willie Lynch says is that as long as these gender roles are reversed, the male and the female will not be able to come to the full knowledge and understanding of themselves. They will not be able to walk in the full knowledge and understanding of themselves. And we was talking about John Singleton on the show last week. And in the movie Boys in the Hood, Lawrence Fishburne, during one of the scenes, he said, the greatest way to destroy a people is to take away their ability to reproduce. The greatest way to destroy a people is to take away their ability to reproduce. The reason that Pharaoh wanted to kill all of the children from the nation that was there was because he said they were producing so fast that they were beginning to outnumber the people in the nation where they were enslaved. So the number one way to destroy a people is to take away their ability to reproduce. This is not just isolated in sexual orientation. This is isolated in all the diseases that the food gives us, that they always give the solution of, oh, you need your ovaries scraped out. A cyst. You know what a cyst in a woman's stomach? A cyst, it comes from foods. Your body is over acidic. So because your body is over acidic, your stomach juices have become so acidic that it's beginning to burn through the lining in your stomach. But do they say we need to give you an alkaline diet? Do they say do they give any solution to the problem? No, they say, well, we need to scrape all your ovaries out. And once they do that, that woman for the rest of her life will be unable to have children. Abortions. We weren't doing abortions before we came here. Abortions was something that was created called Planned Parenthood. And the first abortion clinics was targeted towards the black community. Targeted towards the black community. It was the first abortion clinics. The greatest way to destroy your people is to take away their ability to reproduce. So, a lot of people have told me that they don't believe that the Willie Lynch letter is real. And they don't believe the Willie Lynch letter is real because they believe that the Willie Lynch letter was written probably by some homophobe or something. Whatever may have you. You feel me? And if it was only a target against one group of people, maybe I would concur. But everything that it mentions that this will be created by slavery is there. The divisions on different levels between our people. Light skin versus dark skin. The young people like, man, fuck them old niggas. And the old niggas like, well, fuck these young niggas. The division between the man and the woman. Taking us away from our culture. Taking us away from who we are. Destroying everything that we are. Demonizing everything that we stood for. Completely breaking. It says the goal of slavery was to completely break the black man from one way of living to the other. That was the goal of it. To break the black man from one way of living to the other. So the way we are living now is not the way we were living when they came and got us. All of us are damaged. All of us are hurt. All of us are the products of this system, including me. All of us. So I don't focus on light skin. I don't focus on dark skin. I don't focus on straight hair, narrow hair. I don't focus on gay. I don't focus on straight. I don't focus on homosexual. I don't focus on lesbian. I like what Kendrick Lamar say. I'm fucked up, nigga. You fucked up. But if God got us, then we gonna be alright. My goal is to help you connect to God within you. My goal is to help you find that God within yourself. My goal is to get you to God's presence. And you and God, y'all deal with whatever y'all need to deal with. But that's not my place. That's not my goal. That's not. Because we weren't, like I told my sister, we weren't targeted because we were gay, because of men, because of women, because we were straight, we weren't targeted for any of that. We were targeted because we were black. So as long as your sexual orientation doesn't take precedence over being black, do your thing. You want to date a white woman? You want to date a white man? Hey, go for it. As long as that don't take precedence over being black, that's your business. You understand? Because before I know who you sleeping with, I see a black man. Before I know who your wife or your husband is, I see a black man. Before I know anything about you, the first thing I see about you is a black man. So I deal with being black. Because everything that we have been made to be, the reason we were targeted by the world is because we were black. And now everything that has come as a result of that all stems from that root. So that's what I deal with. I deal with the roots of the matter. So I don't care who you are at all. If you are a black man, if you are a black woman, you are my brother. You are my sister. And we will work together to make a better place for our people. To make better living conditions for our people. To make a place where our children can grow up safe. I don't gotta worry about, is my daughter gonna go out there and get raped? Is my son gonna go out there and get shot by the police? Is my father gonna be taken to jail for trying to feed his family? Is the government gonna come and try to manipulate my mother out of the home? Why does the government have a personal interest in breaking up the black family? Oh, we'll give you money and we'll help you out of the conditions that we created, but you got to get rid of that black male. Sounds like Venezuela. We will help you out and we will send aid to help you out of the economic impoverishment that we created when we issued sanctions against Venezuela. But you got to get that president out of there. It all follows the same pattern. It all follows the same pattern. The serpent never changes. He never changes his tactic. That's why when I hear people say, I don't believe in the devil, I don't believe in Satan, I'm like, then you'll be caught in that web for the rest of your life. Because as the universe would have it, everything that the serpent has done to every nation on this earth has been recorded in some book, in some form. And if you can put together everything that that serpent has done to nations all across the world, you can begin to form patterns. And you can begin to understand who the true enemy is. And it's not your brother. It's not your sister. It's not the black people in your community. It's not the blacks around you. And any black that is your enemy, it is a certain mentality. It is a certain indoctrination. It is a certain program that is running in their mind. Y'all better watch Get Out. Y'all better watch the movie Get Out. And we gotta, you know, I wanna have a show dedicated to breaking down Get Out and breaking down Us. But Get Out, man, couldn't have been no plainer. They were black people, but their mind was not their own. Them people had their mind. And they looked black as you and me, but them people had their mind. So when I read scriptures like, we wage war not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities. Yeah, principality can be a spirit or a demon. Yeah, definitely. We gonna get into them things. We definitely gonna get into the spiritual realm and things like that. But like I said, we taking things one step at a time. If you follow my show from episode 1 to episode 5, it is gonna be a continuation and it is gonna flow into the next thing. I'm not gonna rush anything. I'm not gonna try to cram a whole lot of, if I have to spend a whole entire show talking about the topic, then answering questions about the topic, and then showing how the current events relate to the topic, I will do that. Because as I said, and as I saw every episode, I'm not here to choke you with information. You understand? But there is a pattern that has been created. A pattern that has been created. And when I hear principalities, yes, I understand that principalities are spirit, but I also understand that principalities are principles that we hold in our mind. I've spoken to the Christ spirit. And you notice I call them Christ spirit. I'm very Christ spirit. Because the whole entire world knows who Christ is. The whole entire world knows who that spirit is, even if they don't know him by Jesus. They know who that spirit is. People who have never read a Bible or ever seen a Bible have had encounters and interactions with that spirit. I call it the Christ spirit. People they call witches and voodoo priests and warlocks and all of this stuff, they know who the Christ spirit is. You understand? And when, during my many times speaking with that Christ spirit, he said, demons don't possess your body. He said, demons possess your mind. They possess your way of thinking. They possess your mentality. Right here. This right here, this mind, this generates your whole entire reality. Your reactions to everything that you encounter is what creates your reality. And your reaction is based on your perception. And your perception is based on your mentality, your way of thinking. So because your mentality is wrong, your perception is wrong. And because your perception is wrong, your reactions is wrong. And because your reactions is wrong, you have created the reality that you are now living in. So when I read Willie Lynch and he said, our target is the mind of the slave. I said, oh, no, Willie Lynch letters is real, but this nigga was the devil. I personally believe if God can come in the flesh, I personally believe Satan can come in the flesh too. Because everything I know about Satan, he copies everything that God does. So you can't tell me God can come in the flesh and Satan can't come in the flesh too. No, he can come in the flesh. He comes in the flesh a lot. You see him all the time. He hides in plain sight. It's the principles. It's our way of thinking. So we have to change the way we think. So people will ask me, how can you be pro-black but still be willing to work with, you know, black homosexuals or black lesbians? I'm like, because my perception is different. I don't perceive them the way you do. I can be fully conscious and fully aware of the original nature of our people while still looking at them as my brother and my sister, because my perception is not the same, because my mentality is not the same. Therefore, if you are black, you are my brother, you are my sister, and we all got to work together to get the body. You understand? So we can all be conscious. Back to the question. We can all be conscious. And you know, you can watch the video and you'll see the question. But we can all be conscious. But there is levels to this. I ain't just repeating the Kendrick Lamar song. There is levels to this. Some people say they're conscious. Some people say they're awake, but very few people is activated. Activated, hold on, all right, Royce, brother, you're making stuff up now. What is woke? Your alarm clock goes off, I'm up, but you keep dozing back off. You can be woke, but you still have sleep. You can be woke, you can know some things, but you still have sleep. Being woke is not enough anymore. I'm conscious. I am conscious, and I'm fully conscious, and I am fully aware of my surroundings. I'm not just woke. I am conscious. Okay, you can be conscious. When somebody gets shot in the streets and they're bleeding on the sidewalk, for a while, they're still conscious. They're bleeding to death. But at that point in time, they're still conscious. So, Patricia said, no, you're not. But when you come into what you call consciousness, you must now acknowledge the condition that you are in. Consciousness comes after a period of unconsciousness. So once you become conscious, the first thing you must do is acknowledge and orient yourself with where you are. I've been unconscious. Okay, now that I'm conscious, oh man, I'm in the hospital. Oh man, I got shot. Oh man, this is gonna have to heal. Oh man, I lost the liver. I'm gonna need surgery. You can't be shot and bleeding to death on the sidewalk, but you're like, I'm conscious though. I'm conscious. I'm conscious. Yeah, baby. I'm conscious. I'm real conscious. I'm conscious. Okay, what is your condition? Because as I said, consciousness comes from a state of unconsciousness. So now that you are conscious, what condition are you in? And how can you improve the conditions that you are in now that you are conscious? Being just conscious is not enough anymore. We have to be activated now. We have to be awakened now. We have to reconnect now. The black man being unconscious is as simple as you unplug the phone and now the phone is dead. That's us being unconscious. That's us being unconscious. The phone is dead. So now when you plug that phone into the wall, you can turn the phone on. That phone is conscious, but it's not fully charged. It needs to charge up. It needs to charge. They're not ready. Thank you, Patricia. Being conscious don't mean you ready for what you gotta do. But it is a start. Being woke, that's taking the phone out the box. The phone is out the box. Being conscious, you done hooked it up to the charger. Now it's charging. But being awakened, being ready to make the change in your life. I know so many people who conscious, but their life is still the same as somebody who unconscious. They still doing the same stuff they was doing before they got conscious. But they got knowledge of a lot of stuff. My brother, you ain't there yet. You need to charge so that you can begin to take action to change the situation for you and your people. Knowledge and consciousness is not enough. What are you doing now that you're conscious that you weren't doing when you were unconscious? It's more than putting on an African dashiki. It's more than putting pictures of black women and black men on your wall. It's more than a black Jesus picture. Now that you're conscious, now that you're awake, what are you going to do with your life? What change are you going to make? You got to be activated. You have to be fully charged. Fully charged. And let me tell you something. And you are looking at somebody who is covered with battle scars, covered from head to toe with battle scars. When you become conscious, that is the beginning of the fight. That's the beginning of the fight. When you become conscious. Because as long as the phone is off, everything's cool. But it's not until you begin to charge that phone, it's not until you begin to charge up that soul, that now you begin to realize how many things in the society that you live in is truly against who you are. As long as you are not walking in the person who you are, or even trying to walk into the person that you are, everything is great. It's wonderful. It's a paradise. But it's not until you begin to start trying to walk in who you are. It is not until you begin the process of growing towards the fullness of who you are. It's not just knowledge of self. It is not until you can have knowledge of self. They make fun of us all the time. We was kings. Y'all black people always saying that. We was kings. We was kings. We so tired of hearing y'all niggas say that. We was kings. We was kings. Man, shut up. Get back on your welfare. There ain't no damn kings. It's not just knowing who you are. It's walking in who you are. And it's not until you begin to walk in who you are that you begin to realize how many things in this world is truly against you. Friends you thought were friends start turning. Family you thought was family start turning. You will truly begin to see the truth of your surroundings and where you are when you step up to walk in who you are. You'll see the TVs against you. The radios against you. Your people have been programmed and not against you. When you begin to take this walk towards, I'm not woke, I'm not conscious, but I'm becoming activated, I'm awakening. One misinterpretation of the scripture is that because the scripture has been misinterpreted as if you do not hate your family, then you cannot get into heaven. That was not the original language. Remember something. The original language of the scripture was not English. It was not Latin. The original language of the scripture is Hebrew. Ancient Hebrew, not the Hebrew they have over there, wherever the hell you call them people. If you look at ancient Hebrew, it looks like hieroglyphics. It's not pictures, but it looks like, they called it cave markings. They call ancient Hebrew writings, they called it cave markings because that's how ancient Hebrew looks. This Hebrew that they got is not ancient Hebrew. The original Hebrew is a West African dialect, my friend. A West African dialect. And in the original language, it did not say you have to hate your family in order to get into heaven. The whole entire Latin English Bible is written through their interpretations, through their perceptions, how they understand God. But they cannot understand the original context, that the scripture was supposed to be purveyed in, because they never understood our culture. The Bible was interpreted through their culture. So you must hate your family in order to get into heaven. When most people are referring to heaven subconsciously, they are referring to a place of happiness, of bliss. They are referring to a garden. It says in heaven, there is a garden. It says the garden was in heaven. Now we're going to get into some things, but When people refer to heaven subconsciously, they are referring to a state of being. So from their interpretation and from their understanding based on their culture, in order for you to get into a state of happiness, you have to be willing to hate and betray and turn and separate and abandon everything in order to reach heaven. That's their heaven, not ours. That's heaven for them. That was never heaven for us. Turning your back on your family was never what the black man defined as heaven. If you do not hate your wife, if you do not hate your children, that's not what the original scripture said. That is a misinterpretation. Us as a people, we held the family as a form of God on earth. Man, woman, child. It's the three parts of God on earth. And we are the ones who wrote the Bible. So in the original language, it did not say you must hate your family, you must hate your wife, and you must hate your children in order to enter into paradise. That was never our paradise. That was never our heaven. That was never our mentality. That was never our perception. And when our family came against us, that was never our reaction. So when you enter the path of awakening, your family will come against you. Your friends will come against you. Those you thought was for you will come against you. But you have to understand something. You have to understand what Adam did not realize about Eve. When God came to Adam and said what happened, he said, it's the woman's fault. But Eve only did what the serpent showed her. The serpent didn't give Eve an apple. And then when she ate the Adam apple, she started to do other things and started to come up with other tricks and other deceptions and other ways to now get Adam. No, all she did was say, hey, Adam, I just ate this fruit. It's pretty good. You want to try it? All she did was what the serpent showed her. So when you begin to walk this path of awakening, it hurts when your family comes against you. It hurts when your friends come against you. It hurts when those you thought loved you come against you. But the way to make it past that hurt is not to cut off your family, not to cut off your friends, not to cut off your people, not to cut off your nation. Don't you understand that in solitude we cannot survive? Isolated, we cannot survive. Go to Africa and look at the culture of our people before they took us. And why it says we must reverse the way that they are living. Something that is 180 degrees is a direct contradiction of the original thing. It is not just we're just gonna mix stuff up. Before I ever understood the Bible, before I ever came to a church, ever, I said, I want to know the truth. I want to know the truth. So once I came to the understanding that everything in this society and everything in this nation is a direct contradiction to who we are. It is a direct opposite. It is a direct reversal of who we are. Then what I begin to do, I begin to travel this world and I just begin to reverse everything they ever programmed me to believe. Everything they ever taught me to believe, I just started reversing it. Okay, so when your family turned against you, you need to cut them off. All right, well, if my family turned against me, I'm finna hold on and just pray for them. I'm finna do the opposite of everything you ever taught me. And guess what? I found God by mistake. Everything I heard on the radio, I reversed it. And if a nigga run up, I kill that nigga. I blow his head off, I kill that nigga. All right, well. Since they're not going to tell me nothing that's for my own good, since they're not going to tell me anything that's for my benefit, since they're not going to tell me anything that would actually help me, I'm finna just reverse it. Nah, I ain't going to kill him. I ain't going to touch it. Mm-mm. I started reversing everything they ever taught me. And I done messed around and found God. The real God. The Spirit. El, the Creator. And I'm like, oh. If you said, how did you find me? I would have said, just by reversing everything they ever taught us. He said, so what does that tell you? Understanding that everything you've been taught is a lie. And accepting it. And never using that mindset to dictate how you treat your people. I don't trust no nigga. F all niggas. Who taught you that? The niggas who betrayed me and turned their back on me, who taught them that? The niggas who betrayed them and turned their back on them, I guess. And who taught them that? Is that how we were living before we got here? I've studied the culture of who we are before we got here. And our whole entire culture was built. What's up, Judah? What's good, my boy? Make sure you watch this video from the beginning, man. We're going over some things. But our whole entire culture was built off of interdependence. Our Kebu line, which was, it represents pre-colonial Africa, because Africa was the first thing the colonials did when they came was rename the continent and renamed the different cities in Africa. Black people, you don't know. My people, you don't know who you are. Look up everything, everything. Look up every city in the Bible. Zion, Bethsaida, the pools of Bethsaida, Solomon's temple. Look up all the towns. Nazareth, Galilee, any city you can think of. Mount Horeb, all of these places, look them all up. Mount Zion, Mount Olivet, look up all of these names. And up into the 1900s, all of these locations in the Bible were the name of African cities. There is an African city in Namibia called Nazareth. Mount Zion, that's what the Africans call the mountains in Kenya. The four rivers that Genesis talks about, including the river that runs through Cush, those four rivers, the Bible says the four rivers come out from the Garden of Eden, which means they meet in the Garden of Eden. The four rivers, including the river that runs through Cush, those four rivers, they all meet at the Horn of Africa. When Christ is talking about the jackals, the jackals. Jackals are only in one neck. There ain't no jackals over there where they at. When God was giving the land to Joshua, he said, Joshua, I'm going to have you conquer the land piece by piece, because if I gave you the whole land at once, you would not be able to handle all the animals that are living here. That's in the book of Numbers. See, I don't sit in no church, but I get down with these scriptures. And the reason I understand the scriptures in the way that I understand them is because I took the Bible to God. I didn't let no middleman tell me what the scriptures meant. I took the scriptures to God for myself. And I went to a church for you to add on to what I already knew. But all they showed me was that most of them know no crap either. Because they're not going to God. They going to somebody. You understand? Up into the 1900s, where they conquered Africa and took over everything, that's when they started changing the names of all the cities. Jerusalem is a city in South Africa, but the name's been changed. Bethlehem is a city in Africa. Zion is a city in Africa. Go back and look at the maps before the 1900s, if you can find any. And you will see all the locations mentioned in scripture on the map. And they're all in Africa. Or do you still think it took Moses 40 years to walk from Egypt to where Israel is? Go on your Google map and put in from Cairo, Egypt to Israel. That's an 11-day walk. That's 11-day walk. You look up the distance from Egypt to where they say Israel is, and you tell me how the hell it takes you 40 years to walk an 11-day walk. Oh, God just had them walking around the mountain for 40 years. No. And I'll put the links on my Facebook page so that y'all can go and look this stuff up for yourself and spin off into your own research and get your understanding of it. Before the 1900s, look at all the original names on the map in Africa. Look at where they said Zion was, where they said Jerusalem was, where they said Israel is a collection of places. Nazareth, Jerusalem, Zion, Bethsaida. Throughout the Old Testament, you will see them traveling around to the same places. These places together makes up what Israel is. Now look at where that is on the map. It's in South Africa, going up around the southwestern region of Africa. Now from there, from Egypt to there, on foot, would take 40 years. Not this little couple of hundred kilometers between Egypt and that little place they call up there. So what was our mentality before they came to get us? We was built on interconnectedness. Your people sell blueberries. Your people sell apples. Your people sell strawberries. Your people sell raspberries. You are the only people we can go to for blueberries. So if we hurt you or harm you or destroy you, my child doesn't get his favorite blueberry pie because you're the only people we go to for blueberries. There was no nation burning down one nation and then trying to make the stuff they sell. There was none of that. We were built on interconnectedness. We were built on our dependency for one another. So anything that you have learned while you have been here in America that leads you towards isolation, that leads you towards separation, but for temporarily taking time apart to find who you are, you were programmed to do that. Isolation and solidarity is for you to find who you are, for you to understand who you are. But it's not to hide your light under a bushel. God does not light a lamp for it to be hidden under a bushel. He lights it for it to be put on a high place so that it can give light to the house. And guess what? You can't see everything that's going on in the room when there's no light. When you turn the lights on in the room, all those dirty little secrets are exposed. So if I'm in the room and I'm getting my freak on, and we got the lights off, and we going at it, and you come and flip the lights on me, I might jump up and kick your ass. I don't want you to see what's going on over here. That's a parable. It's the same thing. If we got a whole entire operation going on in the darkness, and you black people want to come over here and be lamps and lights and want to light everything up, we gonna come at your neck. And the reason why the book that our ancestors wrote say that the fight is not flesh and blood, but it's spiritual. Because the spirit can hop in anybody. The serpent can work through anybody. Work through Eve. And that didn't take away from the love that Eve had for Adam. But Adam didn't see the serpent behind. So when you enter this path of awakening, not just being woke, not just being conscious, but really starting to activate and come into who you are. Yeah, your people will come against you. Your family might come against you. Your close friends might come against you. But understand something. I'm not saying you stay there and be no doormat. No, you need to set boundaries. You need to guard your heart. But to keep bitterness and unforgiveness from hindering your growth. Because, oh, you came at me wrong? All right, that's it. I'ma cut you off because me being around you is not good for my awakening. But that bitterness and unforgiveness that you got in your heart because you don't understand why that person did what they did, that's gonna bind up your awakening right there. And you will be alone. You will be in solidarity. You will be in isolation and still just as dead. So we have to understand why people do the way they do. You ain't got to stay around them. You ain't got to keep making yourself accessible to people that's not going to value you. But to keep your heart pure, we need to understand that when you start awakening, that you start becoming a light, the darkness has programmed everybody in the community to attack whatever light may arise. That white man don't do his own dirty work. He hires us to do it. An African man that I study with, I want to have him on the show one day. He showed me a video about baboons and prairie monkeys. Baboons and prairie dogs. Sounds crazy, baboons and prairie dogs, but you can look it up on YouTube. It's on YouTube. And what the baboons would do is they would go to a pack of prairie dogs and they would take one of the little pups away from the dogs, kidnap them, take them away some far where the other dogs couldn't find them or send them out no more. And what they would do is they would abuse the dog every single day. Every day they would abuse it. Jerking it around, slanging it around, biting it. You know, abusing the dog every day. But after they abused the dog, they would come and give the dog water. They would come and bring the dog food. Even let the dog rest. Then it would start all over. Abuse the dog. Beat the dog, abuse the dog, beat the dog, throwing the dog in water, almost letting them drown, and then pulling them out. But then the baboons would feed them and give them water, etc. After a while now, the prairie dog would now start living to stay in the good graces of the baboon monkeys so that they wouldn't abuse it anymore. To a point now, this is on YouTube, this is on camera. If other prairie dogs would come to fight the baboons, the prairie dog that was with the baboons would fight against the prairie dogs to defend the baboons. Because that's how they trained it. That's how they broke it in. I was watching this video like, What is he doing? Oh, look, that's the other prairie dogs. This is your chance. Go back with your family. Go, go, go. What is he doing? Why is he attacking the other dogs? Why is he defending the baboons? What is... And while I'm doing this, the African man looking at me like, now do you understand? And I'm like, what happened? He's been indoctrinated. That's what happens to us. They keep us in poverty. They keep us impoverished. They beat us, abuse us, murder us, slaughter us. Every single day we live in fear. Every day we live in fear for our lives. But the minute somebody around you begins to rise up, their light begins to shine. And they begin giving an alternative to the system. Because the system doesn't want its slaves having any other alternatives. Because as long as we are dependent on this system, they will always use that dependency as a method of control. That's what Willie Lynch said. It said, break away their independence. They're farmers. Their whole entire way of life is based on farming. And for generations and generations and generations, they've been farmers. Okay. We're going to put them in a land of concrete, where you're not even allowed to grow an orange tree in your backyard. You have to go and buy food that's shipped in from other places. This isn't the Caribbean where you can walk down the street and there is no hunger in the Caribbean, because you can walk down the street and pull fruit off trees and grab grapes and things off of the vineyards. Go to the place in Florida where they grow those Florida oranges. It's surrounded by barbed wires. And if you try to hop into that field to get anything on that field, they will shoot you dead. That's what they did to Venezuela. Got Venezuela dependent on them for trade. And then when Venezuela did something they didn't like, all right, we're issuing a sanction against you. Us and anybody affiliated with us will no longer trade with your country. But you built them to be dependent upon your trade. So now when you pull your aid out of the country, the whole entire country collapses. And now you can come and say, well, we want to bring aid because the reason your people are in the condition that they're in is because of mismanagement by your president. That's what they do to us. Look at Nipsey Hussle. Look at Fred Hampton. Look at Marcus Garvey. The feds hired black people to be around Marcus Garvey. Why? Because, wow, for the first time, I'm not a slave no more. They recognize me. They acknowledge me. I ain't got to worry about cops shooting me in the street no more. I ain't got to worry about being murdered by police. I ain't got to worry about that because now I'm in their good graces. That's why they put us in poverty. That's why they strip us down till we have nothing. That's why they treat our communities like hunger games. We're going to take everything out of your communities and leave y'all with just enough for a family. And all of y'all going to have to fight to see who goes home with the spoils. That's why I don't care whether you're gay, straight, stripper, prostitute, killer, robber, dope dealer, gang. I don't give a fuck. I don't care. If you ride for this black shit, nigga, we here together. We here together. We in this together. I don't care where you come from. Ain't no screening process for me. I don't care. If you ride for this shit, then we ride together. Because they made it like this. They made it the way we got to kill for food. The way a woman got to strip for food. The way a woman got to prostitute for food. The way that man got to sell dope for food. They made it that way. You weren't born like that. You were born into their sins and shaped by their iniquities. We weren't born like this. And I understand that. So because I understand that, I understand my people. I understand my people because I understand that. So even when your people are coming against you, you need to see what's behind that and understand who the real enemy is. Understand that we are living inside of a snow globe. We are living inside of a dome. And in this dome, everything is manipulated. Everything is controlled. Everything is manipulated. Nothing happens by everything is manipulated and controlled. So people say, I won't ride for black people. I won't ride for my people. Because every time you try to stand up and ride for them, them be the very same ones that kill you. But they put us in poverty and they put us in this broken condition to make us so hungry and put us in a state to where we would be willing to sell our own just to get a meal, just to have freedom, just to live without fear, just to not be afraid that we're gonna die. That's the reason for all this. That's the reason for keeping us poor, so that we can be controlled. So for that reason, when you carry this light, when you do begin awakening, your circle will get small. Not because you got anger and bitterness towards anybody else, but because everybody is not strong enough to fight that pressure. I don't care. I don't give a fuck. There ain't nothing you can bribe me with to make me turn on my brother. Ain't nothing you can bribe me with to make me turn on my people. Nothing. Because you don't have anything that I want. Nothing. And you gotta surround yourself around niggas like that. Niggas who ain't got nothing to gain, nothing to lose. Niggas who understand who the enemy is. And those kind of niggas are few and far between. Few and far between. You can't let that discourage you from fighting for your people. You can't let this discourage you from your awakening. Because we're slaves. You can't get mad at a slave for picking cotton. Stop that dude from whipping his goddamn back. He ain't picking cotton because he want to. I don't agree with betraying your brother. I don't agree with turning on your brother. I don't agree with nothing. I would never agree with us killing our own, with us hurting our own, especially when they doing something for your community. I never agree with that, and I would never condone that. But we have allowed this to turn into negativity towards picking up the torch and fighting for our people. If Nipsey Hussle was here, he wouldn't be like, you see them niggas kill me? I take back everything I ever did. Bump all y'all niggas. If Garvey and King and all them boys was here, they wouldn't be like, you see, I got killed by my own people. See, if I could, I'd take back everything I ever did for y'all. No. Not at all. You gotta see what's working behind the scenes. We ain't fighting flesh and blood, baby. We fighting against principles. So you can tell the people that are in your circle, whether they tried and true, by their mentality, by the way you think. Frequency. You got 99 jams and you got 103.5 to beat. If you tuned in to 103.5 The Beat, you don't get nothing from 99 Jams. You don't get no reception. You don't get no songs. You don't get no messages. All I get is 103.5 The Beat. Understand? So the people in your circle, they can't even be on that frequency. They can't even be on the frequency. What is your mentality?
Man, fuck these niggas, bro. Niggas ain't shit. Niggas ain't never gonna be shit. So I don't fuck with niggas like that.
But then, nigga, why you riding with me?
Oh, you different.
Nah, nigga. That nigga's tuned into the wrong frequency. Woke, conscious, activated, awakened. Everybody in your circle gotta be on this path. Everybody in your circle has to be on some kind of path to personal growth. You in your circle, y'all have to grow together. Y'all gotta rise up together. If you a candle in your circle, for your own safety and for the safety of your life and for the safety of what you've been put here to do, you gotta ignite everybody in your circle. You gotta make sure everybody is on the path to being awakened. Everybody. Everybody gotta be on the path to bettering themselves, to becoming a better version of themselves, to becoming their higher selves. This growth has to be something that we do as a family. We become family. You can't make all your family come with you. You can't make all your friends come with you. When you begin to awaken, not woke, not conscious, but when you begin to awaken, everybody not gonna come with you because everybody is not strong enough. And for you to bring somebody that is not strong enough to make the journey, but you bring them because that's my family or my friend, you putting them in a position to turn on you because they're not built for that pressure. You can't have nobody in your circle that's not built for that pressure. That's why in episode 1, I said Adam did not realize that when God said dress and keep the garden, that included Eve. You got to build your woman and you got to build your team. And if they don't want to be built, I love you, but you got to stay where you are. And I can tell you that while keeping my heart pure so that it doesn't hinder my awakening and my growth. Because the book that our ancestors wrote, it says the strong have to bear the infirmities of the weak. So if you're not strong enough to walk this journey, that's okay. That's fine. I'll walk it for the both of us. You just stay where you are. So if anybody come to you talking about, do you know anything about him or where he is or what he's doing? I don't know nothing because to be honest, I don't be around him. Good. That keeps you safe. That keeps me safe. And that keeps you safe. This is awakening. Being woke is not enough. Being conscious is not enough. You got to be activated. You saw them boys ban Farrakhan, right? They said Farrakhan is no longer allowed to be on Facebook or Instagram because he is dangerous. That's the path. Being activated, of awakening. And you better know who you are. Because propaganda will turn the whole entire world against you, even your own. Can you pray for them and be like, forgive them for they know not what they do? Not if you don't understand that they truly do not know what they do. That's why we have enlightenment. Inner light. Growing that light within you. When they translate a scripture, they say a Holy Spirit, but African people said nothing about no Holy Spirit. There ain't nowhere in no African, you won't see nowhere in no kind of African culture, no Holy Spirit. That's your soul. Your soul. When they translated it, they didn't understand what the soul was, so they put the spirit. And they understand that the spirit or the soul is something that is subject to desires. The Garden of Eden. Eden means desires. The Garden of Desires. The garden where all of the desires of the soul are fulfilled and met. So therefore, the soul is at a place of rest. See, they ain't gonna... People can't break scripture down to you like that because you can only understand your reality to the degree that you understand yourself. Look it up. Garden of Eden. Eden means desires. It was a place where all the desires of the soul are met. Therefore, the soul is in a place of rest. But when the serpent created that division, El, the creator, said the curse that will now fall upon y'all people is that y'all will now have to work and slave and toil for your desires. So the Holy Spirit, as they call it, or the Holy Soul, it is the soul that is above all desires, aka the soul of God. God has a soul. The three parts of God is his mind, his soul, and his heart. See, people don't understand the scriptures, bro. They just be reading what they heard. The Trinity, mind, soul, heart. Man, woman, child. See? So it's talking about the soul. A man can gain the whole world, but what can he give in exchange for his soul? So when it says, do not quench the Holy Spirit, do not grieve the Holy Spirit, do not resist the Holy Spirit, don't resist your soul. Don't grieve your soul. Because your soul is always with God. Even when we are not with God, your soul is always with God. Always. Your soul came from God. When you look at, I got it here, as we begin to wrap up, or as we wrap up, when God created man, Genesis, I wrote it down, Genesis 1, 26 through 29, where he created man. It says, he created man, male and female, created he them, and told them, be fruitful, multiply, take care of the earth, go. But another chapter later, it said God created another man, and then this man, he breathed in that man his own soul. At that point, Adam was the only man on earth that carried the soul of God. So that soul was there before Adam. It is the soul of God living in Adam, through Adam. And it was that soul that was split into Adam and Eve. So as you awaken, you will begin to realize that everything you've been taught and everything in this reality is artificial and it is a lie. So in order for you to navigate where you need to be, you are going to have to come into a place where you trust your soul. Your soul has been here before. Your soul has done this before. And your soul knows how to navigate. But you got to trust your intentions. A lot of people who are dead because something in them told them not to go out that day. But it's like, you know what? Man, bump that. I'm finna go anyways. And that was the day they died. You know, I wear my little glasses. I remember the day my glasses broke. Couldn't see a god dang on thing. But I still had to drive, and I had to drive a long distance. And I was for the whipping. I ain't care. But my brother, he say, bruh, he say, something in my gut say you shouldn't drive, bro, until you get your glasses. I'm like, oh man, I do this all, man. Yeah, I done this before, man. I done lost my contacts, and I'm way down somewhere far out. I still had to make it home. And he kept saying, he said, bruh, he said, something in my gut is telling me you should not drive, bruh. I'm like, man, you just worry about me. I appreciate you. But when I thought about it, I'm like, man, his soul is telling my soul that I shouldn't. I saw it. He'll tell you, I was just about to pull off. And somebody called me like, hey man, I need a ride. I heard whoopie whoop, so I drive and I get you to where you need to get your glasses. He said, but did you leave already? I was already pulling out. I said, damn though, but cuz say something in him, his intuition is telling him to tell me that I shouldn't drive. So I turned the car back around. I came back. I was like, all right, go ahead, you drive. Your soul is always with God, even when you are not. Because there is your higher self and your lower self. And the goal is for you to become one with that higher self. The self that is above this system. That is above these methods of control and these indoctrinations and these lifestyles and these everything that we've just, everything. The soul that is above it all. You gotta trust that self. And people don't like to trust the soul because the soul is blunt and straightforward. The soul knows the difference between God and all the angels of light. So the soul will tell you, that person ain't right. Them? No, man, that's a pastor. That's a preacher. He can prophesy. He can lay hands. He ain't right. Man, I think the devil talking to me, man. Because there ain't no way he ain't right, man. This guy's anointed. He ain't right. Man, I think the devil talking to me. I bind you, you devil. I bind you. We're in a garden. The book Sun Tzu, Art of War said the greatest thing you can do in war, the greatest weapon you have in war, is to deceive the people into thinking that there is no war. When I read that, I was like, it said the greatest art of war is deception. Deceiving the people, making the people think that they are not actually in a war when they are. So when you first awaken, be careful. Be warned. You're going to realize that you are smack in the middle of a minefield with bear traps. And the only way you can navigate through that thing without ending up just another dead black leader is you gotta trust your soul. Your soul will lead you through. We can take the baton. We can finish the work of Nipsey Hussle. We can finish the work of XXXTentacion. We can finish the work of Malcolm X. We can finish the work of Martin Luther King. We can finish the work of Marcus Garvey. We can finish the work of Huey P. Newton. We can finish the work of Fred Hampton. We can finish their work. But to navigate through this minefield, we got to reconnect to our soul. And we got to become one with ourselves. And understand the state of being that Adam and Eve were in when they were one. You understand? Adam, even at 100%, is only a half. Eve, even at 100%, is only a half. But when two people have done the work to become whole, and two whole, awakened people come together and become one, you create godly seed. And godly seed is more than child. You begin to create a vibrationally new reality. Everything comes from oneness. black nation to be restored. We need oneness. So shots out to Louis Farrakhan. I ain't no Muslim, but I support Louis Farrakhan. I support them 110%. I don't report no religious belief system or nothing like that, but I support them standing on the front lines for the black race. And yeah, they banned them from Facebook. Yeah, they banned them from Instagram. That mean they doing something right. Just like Nipsey Hussle was doing something right. Just like XXX was doing something right. And just like all of the leaders who carried the baton before us was doing something right. But carrying the baton don't have to end in death. We just gotta become one with our soul. And our soul will navigate us through this minefield. So holla at your boy. It's your boy, Brother Royce. One time for your mind. This was episode 2 of G.L.U.E. Movement Radio. Love y'all. Bless y'all. Catch y'all back here same time next week, Thursday, 3 to 6. Holla at your boy. We love y'all. If y'all just tuning in, we out. We wrapping up. But make sure y'all go back and y'all look over these videos. And, you know, it's a lot of good things. You might have to watch it a couple of times to get everything. But you watch episode 1 and you watch episode 2 and you'll be ready for episode 3 next week. Pick up right where we left off. I'll let you, boy. We got you.